Thank you, thank you, thank you. I am very, very expect to this meeting, and I see a lot of people that I know. So you will hear me talking about a lot of things that you hear me talking, but I think if you listen good, you can find a new things, because all the time I try to bring a new things to my lecture. To do it, I will share with you my screen. 1 minute. And I will say something important, that I think it's the most important thing in what I'm doing. It was a very important moment that before I was 16, I left school. And when I left school, I decided to build a new school. And when I left school before I was 16, I was without ability to read and write. I'm dyslexic and dysgraphic in a very difficult way. And also you can hear it's by my language that I try to talk with you English, but everyone here that speak English will see immediately that my English is not exactly the proper English that you expected. But when I see that people from all over the world invite me to talk, I understand that to talk, it's something much more important what you are talking than how you're talking, or is the correct language. And so I will tell you my story that begin when I left school when I was 16. And when I left school, I decided to build a new kind of school that will connect the world that as I see this world to school. Because it was clear to me that school need to prepare people to life or to be part of the life. And around me, I see that life outside school is very simple. Most of the people ask only one question. And this is the central question outside school. And the question is, what I'm going to do with my life? All the other adults around me ask this question. But this question, what I'm going to do in my life, doesn't get inside my school when I was a student. So I thought that I need to build a school that the major question that we deal with this question will be part of the school. And I call it a democratic school. I call it also democratic school because I thought that, okay, we found good way of adults how to run inside society. We call it democracy. So school need to be part of this society. Today, we are talking around 3,000 democratic school all around the world. And I think it's not because my school was so special, because it was people before me that think about the same ideas. They don't call it democratic school, but it was a humanistic school in different ways. I think what happened in the last years that we can communicate by internet, and that pushed the idea very strongly all over the world. And we may begin to make conferences, face-to-face conference like IDEC, and conferences like this online, and the world become like a small village, and it's much more easy to find people that live in different places in the world that believe in the same education like you. If I will say what is the major things that connect all these 3,000 democratic school, I will say that one thing, it's very clear, all of them different. It cannot be two democratic school that will be the same. Because if you community that decide what will be in the community, it cannot be that it exists similar to communities. But what we can found four major ideas that we can find in all in most of the democratic school. The way that we make its practice, it's totally different. So the first thing is democratic community. What it means? In most of the democratic school, children, student, adults, staff member, parents, run the school as a democratic committee. So we make decision together, we build the community that run this decision. If someone break the decision, we have a mediation committee, we have judicial committee. So it's we build something that it's very similar to a microcosmos of democratic country. So that's the way that we do it in every democratic school is different. And I found it's the most beautiful that we are different. The second things that we can see in most of the democratic school is self-direct learning. So in all the democratic school, it's clear to us that it cannot be that different students have the same curriculum. I think that this is also will disappear. I cannot understand how it's happened in traditional school that you give the curriculum only tell me what is your age and I will tell you what you need to know, what you need to learn. No, we don't believe in this idea. We believe that in our everyone is different, and if we are different, we need different curriculums, and we need to be part of the people that make decision about ourselves, what to learn, how to learn, with whom to learn. All this, I call it self-direct learning. Also, the way that we do it in democratic school, we have, I think, hundreds of different ways of how to do it. The third thing that exists in most of the democratic school is dialogue relationship. We don't have hierarchic relationship. Most of the student choose their mentor, the adults that they want to be connected, and we have a very close relationship between the adults and the young people. And it's not only between them, also we try to make a very close connection between student to student and teacher to teachers to build a community with a dialogue relationship. The last thing that it's we can find in most of the democratic school is human rights based content. The most in the traditional school, what it's in the middle of the content, it will be nationality. So if you learn in Israel, you will learn history from the point of view of Israelis or Judaism. If you will learn it in United States, it's from the point of view of the history of United States or in Russia. And we are not thinking that it's right or wrong. It's okay, you can continue to look it's from the point of view of nationality, but it's very important to see it's also from the point of view of the human right. And in a lot of democratic school, when we learn history or when we learn any kind of learning, we look it from the rights of women, from the rights of minorities, rights of animal, about everything. Today, because I'm visiting a lot of democratic school, I see that a lot of democratic schools adapt the 70s goals of the United Nations and try to learn by these 70 goals that become very familiar today with a lot of schools around the world. So this is the four major things that you can find in all the democratic school. I think when we and other people that in this audience today, we try to do something else, not only democratic school, but changing the direction of how a politician in the world thinking, and make the democratic education as an official way of learning in every state in or country in the world. This is, for example, from the European Council, that Terry and me and maybe and other people, we were there, and we will try, and we worked there around, I think, 4 years to convince them to make the democratic school official way of learning in Europe at all. This is a very, very interesting picture that show you, I have a huge project now in South Korea. In South Korea, it was a very sad story 4 years ago. A ship with a lot of people dive, sink, I don't know how to say it in English, sink. And a lot of people died. And on this ship, it was a lot of students. And when the ship begin to sink, the teacher tell the student get to their room and close the room. And when the student was at in their room, they make a telephone call to their parents and say, our ship is sick. And the teacher tell us to be at room, what to do. And most of the parents say to the student, stay at the room and do exactly what your teacher tell you to do. And more than 300 students was died in this accidents and terrible, terrible things. And that's make a huge discussion in the South Korea community. The Minister of Education was fired, the minister at all was changed, and the minister today decide that democratic education, it's something that needed very much in Korea. In the last 2 years, they invite me to open the year of education in Korea. And today I'm working there with a lot of cities, with a lot of teachers, because they understand that what they are doing today, they teach the student to do to make the order of the teacher. And they want to be much more independent. And it's something that if I have time, it exists now in some places in the world, and it's very, very exciting. Here is the same situation in Poland. It's a very complicated situation now in Poland, but in Poland we have around 40 democratic school, and that was the last meeting to me with Ken Robinson, that we know that he passed away in the last more than months. And he was a good friend of me and the movement of democratic education. And so you can see that we try to do a lot of, to change the strategy of countries about what they think about democratic education. This is a picture from China of workshop about democratic education. And you can see more than 800 teachers. That it's very, very, something that it's going very, very fast. And to me, it's making very clear that we are in the moment that it's clear, maybe for me, I don't know if it's clear to everyone, it's clear for me why we call democratic education democratic education. It's clear because I think it was a mistake. Most of the countries today in the world call themselves democratic countries. But most of them adapt the education system that prepare to undemocratic community or culture. So what we can see in the traditional democratic, traditional school, people, teachers tell to the student what to do, how to do, and check them if they done it. That's what happened when they are 4 year old, 8 year old, 70 years old. And then when they come to 80 years old, they tell them, now you are democratic citizen, choose your life. What is the joke? If you teach someone to do what people, strong people above him tell him to do, it's not to prepare to democratic, it's to prepare to another thing. And I think everything that we see today in the world, we are seeing that most of the problem in the world is people that believe to live in their country, they need strong leader that tell them what to do. And I think this is the democratic education is the missing piece of a big puzzle that called democracy. And for me, that's what will happen in the near future. We will see more and more school become more and more democratically because it's not important only to me. I meet now teachers from, or principals from all over the world. And I tell them, it's important to you, democracy? They say, yes, very much. And you feel that something not wrong, working good? They say, yes. And you are worried? They say, yes. And what you think? And then most of the time they jump to, they want to change the president, the prime minister, the country. I tell them why. We have the power to change our countries, but we can change around us. We can change our schools. And I think this is something very strong. If we will change our school, we can change our world. In this case, I want to take you a short vision about what, when I say democratic education, what I mean. Think about this cloud as a cloud, as a cloud of knowledge, and it's doubling itself every half year. And if it's knowledge, it's we need human being. You know, knowledge, it's when information meet human being, it's become knowledge. So this is us, and every one of us is different, and every one of us, it's wonderful. To me, it's wonderful, I will say, because we are different, and I love different. And we are not different only by looking different. We are different by our talent, we are different by our passion, by motivation, we are different. Think if we were the same, it was so boring. Think all of you were Yaacov. It's really, or dairy. It was really, really boring. I think something that moved the world is that we are different and we meet one another and we think differently. And that's make the world go farther and farther. In this case, something happened 150 years ago in the middle of the industrial age. In this time, they build a lot of factories and they use human being as a machine. In this, it was before the, now the new robot. And so it's human being was a machine. And if they want to use human being as a machine, they need to make from all of us that look different the same. So they build a new factory that make us the same. And that's factory called school. And in this school, they put a little bit mathematics, but most of the mathematics was outside of the box. A little bit history, but most of the history outside. a little bit science and most of the science outside. But also that we say, okay, let's put in this box the same student in the same age with the same teacher in the same time, and maybe they become the same. So they push the people inside the box. They say to this girl, you are make a sculpture, but it's not by the core curriculum. So go here. And you make music, but it's not the music of the core curriculum. So get inside and get you inside and inside. And school look like this. It's difficult to see in the school the uniqueness of every child. It's a sad situation. But if you make a zoom in to the box, you find it's not a box, it's a pyramid. What it mean? The excellent area is here in the top and the losers is here. And everyone that was a teacher in his life know that this is the big lie of education. Because every one of us know people that was here a failure, and they in another area of knowledge they become unbelievable. And if we don't know, we need to take example from Albert Einstein, that people say that he is the most genius person that was in the last decades. So Albert Einstein never was excellent student, not in the elementary school, not in the high school, that they throw him out from school and tell him science is not for you. And also in the university, he was the excellent student. And Albert Einstein tell us something very, very important. To me, it's important at least like how to say it in English, but is relative law, but it's not relative, I forgot the name. And he say something to me that it's very important for me. He say, everybody is a genius. Wow, think about this. Everybody is a genius. What he say to us, I think that the science have mistake. It's not exist 1% genius. And I don't think it's 2% gifted. And I don't think that it's 20% excellence. Everybody is a genius. Everyone brings something new to the world. But he continued to say, but if you judge a fish by its ability to climb on a tree, it will live its whole life believing that it's a stupid. He say, if you build a school, he say to us, you need to build a new kind of school, not a school that tell us who is the best. You need to build a school that find the best in every student. So this totally new kind of education. In this kind, what we need to do in the, maybe 20% can find their excellence area in the box, but 80% need to go out and look for their uniqueness, the place that they feel good, or in the place that Sir Ken Robinson calls it the element. It means that the place that your talent and motivation connect together. This is the area that talent and motivation connect together. It's make us with the best place to growing. And I put it like a gas station that you give new energy. You begin to believe in yourself. And also then you can go and deal with places that you are weak. But such a school, it's a very expensive. If I need to build to a different learning plan to every student and give him a teacher, it's become a very expensive school. In this case, we begin to use alternative energy of knowledge. What is alternative energy of knowledge? It exists knowledge that it exists around us that not cost money and we don't use it. This is school, I call it the basic school 1.0. You get money from the government or from parents and run the school. This is school 2.0. This is the future of school that I see today. We use alternative knowledge. What is alternative knowledge? Alternative knowledge, it's for example, student doesn't come empty to school. They come with a lot of knowledge. Why they need to sit and listen to the teacher? Why they cannot teach? I don't know if you know, the best way of teaching, learning something is to teach it. So we can build a school that everyone is a teacher and everyone is a student. Another way of alternative energy is the teachers. Teachers stay at school and they know a lot of things more than what they are teaching. It's important that the student will meet the teacher in something that this is their passion and not the core curriculum of the government. So we can build a lot of knowledge from the teachers. Another group of alternative knowledge is parents. Why we don't need parents only to bring a cake to a celebration or to help to build something. We can use their knowledge to a lot of things that we can make a day of the parents is everyone bring is professional. We can do it all the week. The internet, like we are doing now, why we don't use internet? Free internet, take MOOCs from everywhere and use knowledge from other places to us. And in our community, it exists a lot of unbelievable organization and people that can help us to the school. So to me, good democratic school, it's a school that use a lot of knowledge that around himself and not only from the knowledge of teacher. A bad school is a school that limited by the knowledge of his teacher. We want that if I want that the student will find his uniqueness, we need to use all the knowledge that exists around us. So this is the picture of democratic school as I see it. It's a place that the student can find their element in all the knowledge that exists around them and not in the box. The box disappears. And in this case, we need to find another way of teaching and it's community learning. It's a place that everyone is a teacher and everyone is a student. So the change that democratic education doing is by two things. One, moving from paradigm of pyramid to paradigm of network and moving from the paradigm of this box. I call it the box, the encyclopedia box, because encyclopedia was a great idea to put everything in one box, in one book, but it was great idea of the 18th century. And we are talking about learning in all the knowledge that exists in the world. In this case, let's focus on what is pyramid and network. This is a cell of pyramid. You get information from above and send it down. It's continue like this and like this. What it mean, pyramid organization have three rules. One, knowledge is not important. What is important? What is someone above you tell you to do? So the idea is not what is right or wrong the idea in a pyramid to do what someone above you tell you to do. The second thing is competition between one another. You learn with your friend, but they are also, you compete with them because you want to be the best in mathematics. And the third is that ideas come only from top down. New ideas. The new kind of education, the network, I'm sorry about the Hebrew here. This is the cell of network. First of all, it's not an empty cell. It's with color. What it means with color, to be part of a network, you need to have knowledge in something. You need to be professional in something. When you are professional in something, you find your uniqueness, you begin to see other color. In the pyramid, you see only white and black. Who is with you and who is against you? Here, if you see people that think different than you, with a different color, it's very, very interesting. What is this? Why they think differently? Maybe I missed something. So it's, if you attract to people that think different than you, you are part of a new paradigm, the paradigm of network. It's not mean that you adapt every new idea, but new idea is interesting to you. And network begin when someone that think in this way and someone in another way met together. And we can see it as a big community of learning. And to me, this is something that changed now, not only in the field of education. It's changed everything, everywhere, in the economy, in our working place. We need to work with people that think differently together. And not in the world of, why? Because we can see now in the coronavirus time, the pyramid is not working. Pyramid is making decisions for a long time. It's if you want to do something, you need to get permission from someone above you. And someone above you need to get permission from someone above him. And he need to send someone above him. And then it's disappear. It's not working fast. Network, it's something that new ideas can come from everywhere. It can change in one day. It's very agile way of living. And that's... I think we can see it in all our life, and especially in the classroom. This is the traditional classroom. The teacher comes with a blue materials and he thinks that the student is empty, and then he moves the blue to everyone, and this is successful classroom. In democratic school classroom, the teacher comes with the same blue, but he knows that he believes inside deeply that every student brings something uniqueness. So you need to look what is the uniqueness. And in this case, you can say, oh, this student can teach this student, and this student can teach this student, and the teacher make a network that everyone become a student and everyone become a teacher. We build in this case a democratic classroom that we go to traditional schools in different places in the world. We call it D classrooms. And D classroom is have only two rules. One, all the students are also a teacher. So we learned in this classroom only as a peer learning. And we have a common achievement. What it means, for example, if we make a project, everyone have a different rule. And together we want to success in making the project. Or we do it like a picture of a football team, because that's exactly the uniqueness of the football team, that everyone have different rules, and together we need to achieve goal. Think if everyone in a football team will achieve goal for himself. It will be not interesting. The major things in the football that we walk together, we see one another. And this is the uniqueness in democratic education. Yeah, I want to find my uniqueness, but this is half of the way. I want to see the uniqueness of the people around me. If I see only my uniqueness and I don't see the uniqueness of the people around me, it's not democratic education. It's narcissism. But I think the uniqueness is that you see the other and you see yourself and you know how to work together. So in a traditional school, for example, when we work in, for example, mathematics, we have this graph and we call the student, this is a training game, training game, training game. Training, we teach one another. Game, we make exam. And this is not in democratic education, because in democratic education, we don't have exams. But if we work in traditional classroom, we share with them the average of the classroom. So we learn, and this is the average of the classroom. And then we ask the student, how you think that you can learn better? And then they teach one another, and then we build it like a biofeedback of the classroom, but it can be not about mathematics, it can be all traditional, it can be to organize a trip like this, or to build a project to change the neighborhood like this, that everyone have a different role, and together we want to achieve the goal. So that was the example of how to work from pyramid to network, but how we begin to teach in our school everything, not much more than the teacher, our teacher know. To do this, we use the MOOC. MOOC is a very, very important thing that we are using, and MOOC is massive open online courses. Today, most of the best university and institute and organization have courses online and free without money. This is like IDEC, and or I give you an example of it's not MOOC, but it's online learning of Bill Gates about, it's called the Big Project History. Some of the places that I like to learn by myself, you take all the timeline from and show different things that happened in the history of the world and also what expected in the future. It's very, very exciting. The problem with all the learning by computer is that if you learn by computer at home alone, only 4% success to finish the courses. We say between 4 to 30%. It depends how you do it. But what I do in Israel, we say, let's make MOOCs from all over the world in high schools in Israel, traditional high schools. And now we do it in different places in the world. A lot of democratic schools do it. But in the beginning, the Ministry of Education said to me, what you say? You said that they will learn academic level in high school and they will only 4% finish? I say to him, no. Let's do it MOOC with the classroom. We call it how to MOOC process, but with the classroom, the student will teach student, and we achieve 88% and more. This is the minimum achievement that we see today in the world. So it's very, if you understand it, it's mean that student can learn everything that they want by learning one another, and the teacher become, like we call it a MOOCster, or option that he make a network between the student that they will learn together. You can see here in a Muslim school in Israel, they sit at five, it's before the coronavirus, you see five students sit together, and they in with one computer, they have a course from Stanford University, and when they finish the chapter, they have a card. If they put a green card, it's mean I understand the chapter and I can explain the other. Yellow, it's mean that I have question. Red, it's mean that I don't understand most of the things in this chapter. And they begin to talk between themselves until everyone is green. When everyone is green, they go to another chapter. If they cannot achieve green to everyone, they can go to ask people in the other desk. So everyone help everyone to learn. It's not that we someone against someone. And it's become very, very informal way of learning. And this is the same class in China today. And this is a workshop that we done to teachers in Moscow. And you see also here, they see teachers in Moscow with the cards, but I bring this picture to show you this picture. This picture is, we make the workshop, it was 3 days. This group decide to learn with the process of how to move hip hop. So they learn hip hop dance by the computer. And that was fascinating. So what we can see more is that also it's change of the classroom. The classroom, if you believe that every student is different, you don't need this way of traditional, and you can put white book around you and children can teach student. And here you can see student teach student, or like table, or this classroom with 80 students without teacher, that they are teaching one another. In our, what we do today, we break the traditional classrooms. You see, you remember, you can imagine this is, and we make it clarified. It was very interesting here because this is a group from China that come to visit our school in Israel, and the teacher from inside tell them get inside, and you see this is the Chinese visitors, and the children learn by team, and they cannot see the visitors. They are in a really flow of learning. So the traditional school is look like a co-working place, and the idea is that the pyramid box learning is a teaching-based school. And we are moving to a paradigm of network and learning in a learning community in all the area of knowledge, and we call it learning-based school. So we are moving from teaching-based school to a learning-based school. And the second thing that we are doing is moving to do it not only at school and do it in all the city. And all the city become one big school. And you can see principals from different schools in one of our cities, in place that we call it Innovating Lab. And they begin to think how to make connection between the cities inside the school. This is the teachers that begin to think how to work together. And students begin to learn in different school, but also in different project that exist inside the city. Or here is people that go to pension and meet the student and teach them. Or we make a conference in the main street. This is Sugata Mitwa, and this is people that make a conference inside the city. And today we have also, it's in Ibu, but it's application that we call it EduCoin, that we can use money to education, that people in the city can give to other people a way of innovative learning. I will finish with the coronavirus that happened to every one of us. And in the coronavirus, most of the time we were here in the red circle, that we have a lot of power that push us to do exactly what we done in the past, and the new idea how to be a learning community. When the coronavirus come, it's like become a pushing to the old what we want to achieve. And in one day they say that we don't go to school, and if we don't go to school, we begin to live our dream. And that's it was a big wave of zero and one on us, and we begin to work as in a Zoom between children from all over the world. And today we are talking about hybrid school, a place that we work at school in the houses. But the major idea we try to do in all these places, we don't have enough time that I will share with you. I think if you understand the idea of democratic education, it means that different is beautiful. You can do its unbelievable things in your home, in your cities, and your school. And also, the world become more safety and more safety. In this case, I want to stop. I will give you I will give you this map in Padlet. And if every one of you, I will send the Padlet address in the chat. Every one of you that want to share with all of us new ideas and how to do things in democratic education, please write to us in the chat, and I will try to connect you with one another. So you have now the chat, and you can write in the chat, in the Padlet, your name, from where you are. It's a map, so it will be where you are, from the school you are, and what you want to share with the people, or if you want to ask question, or you need to ask help, everything, I will connect you. So,
that is beautiful.
Thank you. And Richard, I don't know if we have time. We will be glad to answer a question, or you decide what we can do.